invite you all to stand and worship with us today. Now the darkness fades, it's a new beginning. As we lift our eyes to the hope beyond, as creation waits with an expectation to declare the reign of the Lord our God. We will not be moved when the earth gives way. For every fear, there's an empty grave. For the risen one is overcome. Now the silence breaks in the name of Jesus. As the heavens cry, let the earth respond. All creation shouts with the voice of triumph. I'll declare the reign of the Lord our God. We will not be moved when the earth gives way. For the risen one is overcome. And for every fear is an empty grave. For the shall reign, and he shall reign forever. Strongholds now surrender, for the Lord our God has overcome. Who can be against us? Jesus our defender. He is the Lord and he has overcome. Sing that again. God has overcome. Who can be against us? Jesus our defender. He is the Lord and he has overcome. We will not be moved when the earth gives way. For the risen one is overcome. And for every there's an empty grave, for the risen one is overcome. We will not be moved. We will not be moved when the earth gives way. For the risen one is overcome. And for every fear, there's an empty grave. For the good to be here with you all this morning in the house of the Lord. We're excited to worship with you. Yeah, we just want to welcome you to the service, and we've got some songs to share, and we just pray that it touches your heart, and yeah, that God just moves in this place today.
Say it as well, when my voice can barely speak. How can I sing you a song in the midst of suffering? Jesus, will you meet me here? Let soul to sing. My God is still in control, and still He reigns on His throne. Though mountains may tremble and sea billows roll, I'll sing.
Times I fail, still Your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, still I'm caught in Your grace. Everlasting, Your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, Your glory goes beyond all faith. Thank you. purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all faith. Yeah, my heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out.
Your will above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all grace.
In my heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the
Jesus, I come, Jesus.
Lord Jesus, thank you that we can come just as we are. You redeemed us. You poured your grace out on us, Jesus. You hung on the cross so that we can be free. And we praise you. We worship you. God, thank you for being here this morning. Thank you for your presence is here. We claim that in the power of your name. And I pray your glory would invade our spaces in our hearts and our minds. Would you be with us today in the power of who you are? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you guys with the worship team. You guys are awesome. And it is good to have you here this morning. Welcome to all of you. There's kids' church in the back. So the kids can head on back for that. And if you're visitors here this morning for the first time, we especially welcome you. And we also invite your kids to be part of that. And the leaders, directors are back there. While the kids are going back, I want to invite all of you to baptism service tonight. It's going to be a phenomenal time, a great time. We're going to have some worship, a little bit of word to be inspired with, and then nine people are getting baptized. So that's at 5 o'clock tonight. We'd love you to be part of it. In addition to that, a very big welcome to all of you ladies. If you ladies are feeling like, especially if you're stay-at-home moms and you get all bottled up and winter's coming and you're going to get bottled up more, Tuesday mornings at 9 o'clock, the ladies' Bible study is in the back. They would love to have you part of that. If you want more info, speak to my wife, Zonia, and she'll get you in touch with what you need. I'd like to start this morning with just a few minutes of prayer time again, and I know we just got done praying. But there's some needs that are going on among, friends, part of the church family. I want us to especially pray for Irma. She's been, this is Mo's wife, Irma Yoder. She's been in the hospital for now more than a week and trying to figure out what's going on. If you remember correctly, we've been praying for Mary Beth Raber. Let's pray for continued healing there, as well as I know Merv's wife, Leona, is not doing well as well. So I just want to recognize them in the power of God's healing. Would you do that with me? Would you bow your heads? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you that you are, you're the healer. And Jesus, I know we can bring everything before you. So God, I pray that you would touch our hearts, touch each one that's listening online this morning. But God, most of all, with your healing hand, would you touch those that can't be here this morning, or those of us that are here this morning with some kind of ailments that are maybe even frustrated that we have to walk through this. But Jesus, I pray you'd heal. I pray you'd touch. May you especially be with Irma this morning in the hospital room. Give her peace, strength. And God, I pray for a miracle of healing in her body. Keep healing Mary Beth Raber. I pray your blessing on her. God, I pray you'd touch with healing Leona. I pray that you would just help her to have strength today and to be able to move around well. God, I pray for a special touch for all of us this morning. God, we dig into your word again, and day after day, Sunday after Sunday, we dig into your word and we want something. And God, I just praise you that your word is always new. So I pray this morning that you would spark that newness in our minds. God, you know that there's nothing I can say that will make any kind of difference in any of our lives. But Jesus, I know you do, and your Holy Spirit prompts us. So God, I pray that any words I might speak this morning, that you would want to stir in our hearts, you would help them to be atomic in our minds and our hearts. Create a space in our minds that we can invite you in, that we can listen to you speaking to us. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Well, I want to continue our study in the book of James, and if you're getting tired of that, I give you full assurance that this is the last Sunday you have to walk through this with me. If you're not tired of it, continue studying it on your own, because the book of James is pretty cool. And as I mentioned, last Sunday I mentioned this, but I'm very, willing to admit and apologize to you in some sort of fashion that we've not exactly done justice to a lot of the points in the book of James. So I hope this inspires you to study the book of James on your own and dig even more. However, I hope you've gleaned something from these sermons in the book of James. And today, as we wrap it up, that can help you learn more about Jesus and his kingdom and his family, whom you're a part of if you believe in Jesus Christ this morning. Oh, so we're in the last part of the book of James. If you have your Bibles with you, open them. If you ever get discouraged in bringing your Bibles with you because we have it in the overhead and you think, well, maybe it's not worth my time, trust me, it is, because you can underline things in your Bible. You can, mark it in your Bible and not the less to say, I think it's pretty credible to have your Bible with you on a Sunday morning to read through this with me. So open your Bibles into the book of James. We started the last chapter 5 last Sunday, got about halfway through it, and we are ready for verse 13. Sort of a whole new subject. So this morning I'm excited because I was digging into this and I got way carried away with a lot of little bunny trails in my studies, and I hope I don't do that in my sermon this morning, or you might be here till way too late that everyone would be mad at me and not come back next Sunday. But James chapter 5 verse 13, James starts out with this. He says, is any one of you in trouble? He should pray. Is anyone happy? Let him sing songs of praise. Is any one of you sick? Yes, there is. We just prayed for some of us. He should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And I'm going to stop there for a minute, because there's so much packed into this. Before we start in the controversial part of the scary topic of faith healing, which I know some of you want to argue about, but we can argue later. But I want to begin with this very simple question that I propose to you. A very practical, I think, question is, why should this kind of practice that James is talking about, right? He's talking about when we're sick, we pray. Why should this kind of practice, really that James is urging us to do, and actually he is, he's really urging us to do this. Why should this be anything other than the normal? You follow me? So James says, listen, when you're sick, you should pray, right? Why should this be anything other than the normal? Because any of us as believers in Jesus, any of us that know anything about Jesus at all, we know that Jesus, this is what he did, right? I mean, we know what he was. He was a healer. So much so that many people, when Jesus lived here, and you can read about this if you study your Bible, many people called him the healer. It's who he was. It's what he did. Because healing is what he did. They would call him this. We know this is what he did because we've read it and we continue to read it in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, as I've noted. And we read this history of life that Jesus lived. And you can read about this. And, you know, you can start jotting these down, or you can click it in your memory, or you can open your Bibles and mark it. But in John chapter 4, Jesus did this with the official's son. Remember, he healed him. I mean, in John chapter 5, he healed the lame man at the pool of Bethesda. In John chapter 9, the man who was born blind, he healed. He brought him sight. Matthew 9, the paralyzed man, he healed. I could go on and on, but you know this already, that when Jesus lived here, this is what he did. And you can do the homework yourself. So your homework this morning, and I should actually note this. You know, I hope you come on a Sunday morning. By the way, another reason to bring your Bible. Even though it's on the overhead, I want you to know your homework every single Sunday morning is to validate that what I'm preaching, what I'm saying, what I'm telling you the Holy Spirit inspired is actually for real, right? That's your homework, right? We don't, as believers in Jesus, we don't just sit blindly and say, all right, you know, somebody just go tell me everything to believe. No, you dig. So your homework this morning is to dig into God's word and make sure that what I'm saying is correct, but especially in the fact that Jesus was the healer. He did this, but not only did he heal, he also healed through believers in Jesus. And again, once again, you're probably saying, well, I know this already, and you should, because many of you have seen examples of this in real life, walk through examples of this in real life, where God performed the miracle of healing. But perhaps one of the first examples that Jesus did healing through people, you know, after he got done living here and was ascended back into heaven, is recorded in Acts. You might know this verse, but in Acts chapter 2, there was these two men very much like you and I, called Peter and John. And Peter and John, by the way, weren't some angels or weren't some, like, specifically, you know, spirits that came to live in a body. They were men like you and I, contrary to what you might believe, but they were. They were men like you and I, followed Jesus Christ, lived with Jesus. We know this, right, for 3 years. But in Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 10, I'm going to read that. I think I have it in the overhead. But Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 10, I'm going to read this experience that John and Peter had after Jesus wasn't any longer with them. Acts chapter 2, it says, when the day of Pentecost came, my bad, I think it's Acts. Should probably have my stuff straight. Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. So don't follow the overhead. By the way, This is when you should have your Bible. Acts chapter 3, verse 1 through 10. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. A crippled man from birth was being carried to the temple gate that was called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When the crippled man saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. And Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Well, silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." And taking him by the right hand, he helped him up. And instantly, the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet. I like that word, jumped. Like, it's not like just like, "Oh, I am slowly." I mean, he like jumped to his feet because he's now healed, right? And he began to walk. And he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God, which we're going to talk about in a minute, praising God. But anyway, when all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple that called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to them. The crowd was amazed, right? The crowd is like, "Oh my goodness, what just happened? This man was lame. Jesus isn't here anymore." Like, they knew Jesus healed. They heard the stories. They were around him. They remember Jesus was called the healer because they called him that. But this was amazing. Peter and John, as followers of Jesus, are now facilitating healing. Now, Peter and John, they weren't so surprised. Why? Because they believed in Jesus. Why? Because they believed the words that Jesus said, and I think they remembered them. How do I know this? Because they're recorded in John chapter 14. I think I have this. In John chapter 14, reads like this. It's recorded in verse 12 through 14. Jesus speaking, he said, "I tell you the truth." You got me here, Tristan? John chapter 14, verse 12 through 14. He said, "I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing." What's Jesus been doing? Somebody say it. Healing. Thank you. You were listening. He was healing. So Jesus says, "Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing," now known as healing. "He will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask anything in my name, and I will do it." And Peter and John knew this. And of course, John would remember. He's the one who recorded it, right? The book of John, John chapter 14. So John recorded this. They believed in Jesus. They knew Jesus meant what he said. So they're facilitating this healing. And so the scenario in Acts chapter 2 that we just read happened. You know, they're going up to the temple to pray, and hey, dude, here's a crippled man, and it's like, well, he's begging, he's asking us to give him something, right? And I can just sort of imagine this, like, John's like, or maybe Peter's saying, "Well, you know, we don't really have any money. I mean, we're like broke," which, by the way, if you do a lot of ministry, you're probably broke. Unless your name's Joel Osteen. Well, that wasn't necessary. But anyway, but they're doing a lot of ministry. So Peter's like, "Well, we're sort of broke." And Peter's like, "Yeah, you know, you're right, we are." And James says, John says, furthermore, we should probably keep moving because we got some praying to do, right? We're going up to the temple to pray. And then, you know, Peter's like, "Well, John, you're right again, but, you know, we'd know Jesus would probably stop and heal him." Imagine this little interaction of conversation between Peter and John, and then John's like, "Well, yeah, that's probably true, and, you know, we do have that power. Jesus said we do," and so happens the story that we read. But in the ministry of Jesus, this was not something new and crazy. It's what Jesus did, right? So James knows this. So now if we go back to our text in James, I told you there's some bunny trails, but if we go back to our text in James, he knows this, the original believers in Jesus knows this, and James's mission is to let all of us know that believe in Jesus from 2,000 years ago till now. James's mission is so that we know Jesus heals. And he wants you and I to know that this should be the norm. You know, like not even just the healing part, but, you know, look what he says. He says, "Are you happy? Let him sing songs of praise." James wants us to know that we should express our emotions to God. Are you with me? I want you to listen to this. I believe, you know, James wants us to know we should express ourselves to God. And not even just in the praying part. We'll get to that again in a little bit. But how about what he says? If you're happy, let him sing songs of praise. This is probably so unnecessary to say, but some of you are never happy on a Sunday morning. And you're like, oh, no, 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 no. What do you mean I'm never happy? Like, this is my happy face, you know? I'm always happy. Well, I don't think you're very happy because some of you stand here and you watch your worship team and you're looking at your phone a little bit or you're, maybe sipping some coffee and, well, this is sort of cool. Well, if that's your happy face, I'll pray for you because, and maybe some of you are thinking, well, I'm taking offense to this because I'm never not happy, right? Well, okay, maybe you're happy on a Sunday morning, but then you're not taking seriously what James says, right? James, as a spiritual leader, understands Jesus very seriously. And James is very adamant with the fact that, listen, you should express yourself to God. Now, some of you, this is not for you because I hear some of you singing really loudly and I love it and it's awesome. And by the way, you don't have to be in tune. You can just sing. It doesn't matter. Bring a joyful noise to God. But James says, express yourself to God. Express yourself to the church family. You know, don't bottle up your joy. By the way, did you know if you bottle up your joy long enough, the joy's sort of going to go away? We should probably talk more about this because I really am, and I don't mean this like, don't feel beat up. I'm being serious. Like, don't, you know, if now next Sunday morning you'll be like, oh, Steve's looking at me like, I got to quickly mouth words. I'm not trying to beat you up, but I am worried about our lack of emotion in time of worship. I'm being serious. Maybe it's our stoic upbringing, or maybe it's because we don't understand the glory of Jesus. Maybe it's because we don't understand the power and glory of God and who He is. And, you know, someday I think we will. Someday, you and I, as believers in Jesus Christ, are going to stand in the glories of heaven. And I don't think we're going to be doing this. I mean, I hope that God has coffee in heaven for sure. But when we see the glories of God and His Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, I think we're going to be stirred up and excited and express ourselves. I should probably get off that bandwagon. But if you realize who you worship then, and if you're going to be stirred with emotion then, we should probably start now. So James says, listen, I want you to show some emotion. I don't want you, by the way, to bear your burdens of sickness like some young warrior that, you know, is too proud to show feelings. That's why he says, you know, pray and let yourself be known that you have issues. Look what he says in verse 15. He says, let's start over. In anyone you trouble, he should pray. Is anyone happy? Let him sing songs of praise. Hallelujah. Is any one of you sick? Quit being so, you know, proud and warrior idea-like and handle it all yourself, but rather call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. See, Jesus did this. Jesus healed, but Jesus says we should do it, right? And Jesus says we can do it. We just read that verse where Jesus says, you know, if you believe in me, you're going to have all the power that I have and you're going to do what I'm doing. So yeah, okay, we're going to pray. We're going to anoint with oil. We're going to lay on hands. And we're going to do it regularly, right? You all with me? As believers in Jesus, this is what we're going to do when someone is sick and in need of God's healing. And by the way, a little another bunny trail. We're not going to wait to do this to like it's your last resort. Like the man's dying. Pastor Steve, can you quickly come and anoint him? For some reason in our strict religious settings, that's the deal. And I have no idea where to get this. Because that's not what James had in mind. I can assure you. So we're going to do this. We're going to pray. We're going to anoint with oil. By the way, that whole thing about waiting till last minute would preach, but we won't go down that bunny trail anymore right now. But we're going to expect healing, right? We're going to pray. We're going to like open ourselves up to each other. Let each other know we need healing, and we're going to pray. We're going to anoint with oil. And we're going to expect healing because Jesus said it would happen. Jesus said it's going to happen. We just read the verse where Jesus said, if you pray in faith, then I'm going to do it. And some of you are thinking, oh yeah, Pastor Steve, but what if it doesn't? Yeah, you're right. For every person that I've miraculously seen healed in a moment of prayer, I've probably seen 10 die. So like, Jesus, what's up with that? I mean, this whole thing doesn't make sense, James. You're saying, you know, if we just pray and anoint with oil, you're going to be healed. Well, a few things I want to make sure you understand this morning. I'm going to say this very, very boldly. Maybe because I just don't care, or maybe it's because I'm so passionate about this. When we pray for healing, two things I want you to remember when praying for healing. Number one, if that healing does not come in the form of your body becoming healthy, it does not mean that you do not have enough of faith. And I'm saying that very boldly to all of you online because I'm very passionate about it. I can't say that clearly enough. And if somebody is telling you this, it's not from God. There are people that are giving words of condemnation to somebody who's sick and are saying, if you have enough of faith, your body will become healthy. Those are words of condemnation that Satan uses from men and women to incriminate the hearts of believers in their final days here on earth. I believe that with all my heart. And it's not from God. I speak very strongly against those words of condemnation. However, I also speak very strongly on the need for us to have faith in prayer when we're sick, when we need healing. As some of you know, as I just mentioned, some bodies don't get healed. We can talk about this, and we will in a minute, because some of you are sitting here this morning, and I've anointed loved ones of yours, and they're not here anymore. So don't let anyone ever tell you you haven't had enough of faith. Those are words of condemnation, not from God. Number two, the next thing I want you to know is God's form of healing is not always what we have in our minds as healing. You see, we think this healing means things that our bodies will get better. I hate to inform you, but the healing of this nature will absolutely not always be the case. 100% absolutely. You're like, well, how can you say that? Because ever since Jesus said these words 2,000 some years ago, and ever since James wrote this, every single person since then and now has still died at some point. Are you with me? See, I believe the greatest faith healers, and I don't mean that, I mean, we're all faith healers, right? But the faith healers that preach condemnation to those people that they say, don't believe enough or you'll be healed, at some point, they die. And so they're at that point recipients of their own words of condemnation. What I'm trying to tell you is God decides what healing looks like, not you and I. God decides what healing looks like, and he may choose to heal the body of that person that we are praying for in some awesome, immediate action that's amazing, and then they have another 5 or 10 or 20 or maybe even 50 years of life. And God might choose to do that, which is an amazing miracle. After which, he's still going to call them home, and they're still going to die. But he's going to call them home and give them a brand new body. So he might choose to do that. He might choose to heal them in that instance of prayer. And again, you have another 5, 10, 20, 50 years of life with your loved ones, which is a miracle. Or through our prayers and crying out in faith, he may call them home to be with him and give them 100% complete healing with a brand new body. And through the journey of death, he gives them peace. He gives them confidence. He gives them joy. That is the ultimate healing. For someone to walk through death and have faith and peace and joy, that is the healing. This whole idea that healing has to be in your body is just not right. And faith will get you the ultimate healing of peace and joy and confidence even as you walk through death. So faith installs this confidence within you that you're ultimately going to be healed in the same way that Jesus rose from the grave, and you're going to have this brand new body for all of eternity. And God, in his ultimate authority and power and truth and ultimate wisdom, gets to choose that timing. And he gets to choose how that healing's going to look when you pray, when you anoint with oil. So now some of you argumenters are already thinking, well, if God already chooses and God just decides that, then you know, why should I even bother praying? Why, well, you know, why should we even anoint with oil? God's going to choose. No. Here's why we should bother praying for healing. Number one, praise and worship do affect the decisions God makes. If you don't believe that, we'll talk about that again in a minute, but the Bible is full of these examples. Again, in a minute, we're going to be at verse 17, and James uses one of these examples then, so hold your horses. Number two, prayer and worship strengthens our faith. And remember what our faith does. Our faith ultimately heals us so that whether we walk through the journey of death or not, we have faith, we have confidence, we have peace. Now, if that's not healing, I don't know what is. And then the ultimate healing of a new body for eternity. That peace and joy and confidence that someone can carry through the journey of death. And all of us sitting here this morning, we've never died, right? So you're like, well, what's that about? You've seen people die. Some of us have loved ones that have died. And when there's a peace and a joy and a confidence through that journey, that is healing. So with all of this, I hope you understand what James is trying to tell us to do. He says, cry out to God. Express your emotions. Pray for healing when you're sick. Anoint with oil. Pray. Worship God in his holiness. And God will pour out healing in the way that he sees fit. So we're like, okay, James, we get all that healing part, but what about the end of verse 15? If he has sinned, he will be forgiven. And then 16. Therefore, look what he says. Put me back up here, Tristan. Verse 16. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. What is up with that? I thought we're talking about healing. Like, okay, so Steve, you're saying the ultimate healing is like peace, joy mentally, you know, in my soul, and then a new body for eternity. And then the other part of healing is when my body actually will get healed. But now he's saying, well, you should confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so all that can happen. What's that about? Well, first of all, back to, you know, who Jesus is, the healer, and what he does. He's the healer, but he's also the what? The forgiver of our sins. Because of who he is and because of what he's done, all of your crimes and sins and the selfish junk that's in your heart and the messed up person you are, Jesus forgives all of that. So Jesus is like the forgiver. And recorded repeatedly in the Bible, if you study your Bible and do your homework, recorded repeatedly, Jesus spoke the powerful words of forgiveness when someone needed healing. If you don't believe that, look at Luke chapter 7, look at Luke chapter 5, look at Mark chapter 2, to name a few. Matthew 9 verses 1 through 8. I actually want to read that because it's really good. Matthew chapter 9, verses 1 through 8. I told you there's going to be some bunny trails, but we're going to keep moving. Matthew chapter 9, verses 1 through 8 is an incredible story. I love it. Jesus stepped into the boat, crossed over, and came to his own town. Some men brought him a paralytic lying on a mat. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, take heart, son, your sins are forgiven. Like, Jesus, this guy needs to walk. What are you talking about? Sins forgiven. It's because it's more important. We'll get to that. At this, some of the teachers of the law said to themselves, this fellow is blaspheming. Knowing their thoughts, Jesus said, why do you entertain evil thoughts in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or say, get up and walk. But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. And then he said to the paralytic, by the way, now that your sins are forgiven, get up and take your mat and go home. The man got up, went home, and the crowd saw this. They were filled with awe, and they praised God. Remember, the ultimate healing is what? the forgiveness of our sins, the peace, the joy, the change of our hearts. So that's the ultimate healer that Jesus is. And Jesus is a master forgiver. Forget the healing part for a minute. Forgiveness is what we need. And this is all made possible, this healing for all of eternity and a brand new body to live in heaven forever with Jesus. All of this is made possible because Jesus forgiving our sins and dying on the cross. Is that not so much more important than your big toe being healed? No, I'm just being light. But is not that so much more important than my cancer being better? Right? The ultimate healing is that our sins are forgiven, that I have this peace, joy, confidence, that I can walk through death and smile with my last breath. This is why we praise God. This is why Jesus Christ, his son, should mean the world to us. This is why, back on the bunny trail, and I should probably just stop, but this is why on a Sunday morning when we're worshiping, I'm not just going to be there like, oh, this is cool. It's not cool at all. It's intense worship of who Jesus is. God in his glory. And you're all healing for all of your life, your mind, your soul. All of eternity is all because of Jesus. Do you understand now why we should put some emotion into this? This is what James is saying. I mean, James just speaks into this. He's like, you know, be humble. This is what he says. Put me back up in verse 16. He's like, you know, be humble. Confess your selfish hearts. You know, pray that God makes you more like Jesus. Confess your sins. It doesn't mean like, you know, I'm going to call up Eugene and be like, dude, I lied yesterday. And, you know, and call up Chris and like, I'm so sorry. I was angry with my son yesterday. No, the forgiveness of the confessing our sins to each other is in humility. Unloading our selfish hearts and saying, I really want to be different. I want to be more like Jesus. And I know I haven't reached it yet, but God is helping me. And Jesus on the cross forgave everything I've ever done. And that brings us ultimate healing. And maybe healing in our bodies for a few more years, if God chooses to do that, by our pleading to him. You know, maybe, back to verse 16, it says, the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Remember, God can choose to do that, and God might choose to heal your body and extend that dash on the gravestone by like an eighth of an inch. You know what I mean by that, right? And, you know, instead of 1977 to 2022, it might say 28 or something. But that's not the main goal. That's not the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal is that Jesus forgives everything about me. He gives me peace and joy. And the best healing is being forgiven, being healed inside. And having confidence through death. And that's what James is trying to tell us. Prayer does that. And at the end of verse 16, you know, he says about this prayer thing, And like I said, he says that the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. I'm going back to James because my Bible is at all my bunny trails. Verse 17, I like this. James is like, you know, he says that the prayer of a righteous man was availeth much. And he's like, by the way, if you need an example of this, look what he says, verse 17. Elijah was a man just like us. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain in the land for 3.5 years. And again he prayed and heavens gained rain and the earth produced its crops. Here's your homework. I'm telling you, forget your novel. I like that. The shirt that Drew had on today, if you didn't notice. You know, novels down, Bibles up. Put down the novel and read the book of 1 Kings chapter 17 and 18. Because I'm telling you, it is action-packed. And this is what James is referring to. He's like, guys, I want you to remember Elijah. And, you know, just, you know, as a spoiler to that, in case you're not going to read it, let me know. But as a spoiler to that, in the beginning of chapter 17, Elijah brings God's anger to this wicked king Ahab. And he's like, you know, God's going to keep the rain and the dew for like the next few years. And then Elijah goes hiding in a brook and he gets hungry and he gets fed by ravens. Imagine that. The brook dries up. He goes to a widow's house and comes to a widow's house. The widow's like, well, I really don't have much food or anything to give you because the little I have left I need. And you know, I don't have anything substantial to give you. And Elijah's like, it's okay, it's okay. If you If you feed me, that bag of flour will never get empty and that canister of oil will never get dry. And sure enough, God does that. She feeds him and, you know, the bag of flour never gets empty. The can of oil never gets dry. And then the son dies, the widow's son dies. And then Elijah brings him back to life by the power of God. And meanwhile, the drought continues. And this is all in chapter 17 and 18. You should read it. It's action-packed, I'm telling you. And then like after 3 years, God tells Elijah, you know, I'm thinking about this rain thing. By the way, Bruce and Lester, I don't know if Bruce is here or not, but Lester, if it wouldn't rain for 3 years, like as a farmer, you're pretty much screwed, right? Like that's it. You're not raising crops anymore. So 3 years without rain or rain or dew, right? No water. And so finally, God's like, well, we should probably think about rain again. So again, this is all in chapter 17 and 18. And he says, well, Elijah, I want you to, you know, go talk to this King Ahab. And meanwhile, in the same, again, in the same chapter, it says that Jezebel, Ahab's queen, is, you know, killing off people. We can talk about that, but we won't. So God tells Elijah to go and talk to this King Ahab. And Elijah meets Ahab and tells him that he has everything messed up, right, with all these evil prophets he has. Long story short, Elijah says, we should call everybody to a big rally. You know this story, right? All in chapter 17 and 18. But Elijah calls all of these evil prophets to a big rally. And he's like, I want to prove to everybody whose God is the most powerful. So you guys, you know, you go first and you go ahead and build an altar and pray for fire from your, you know, evil gods and Baal and see if he lights it up. And again, those chapters are action-packed because they start praying out to their evil guy and they're like, their evil God, and they're like, you know, light fire, and it doesn't happen. So they literally start slashing themselves with their swords. True story, read it. And they start dancing, going crazy for like 8 hours. No fire, right? And then Elijah's like, all right, dudes, it's my turn. And he pours a bunch of water on the altar and cries out to God, and God just lights it up, right? Burns everything. Read the story, it's awesome. But that phenomenon could only be explained by the power of God through prayer. And then if you still go on to the end of that chapter, back to what James is saying, the need for rain still persisted. And so, God knows this, and Elijah prayed, and if you read the story, pretty cool is Elijah kept praying, and he tells his servant, like, go out and check to see if it's raining. 7 times. And finally, the 7th time, the servant goes out and is like, dude, I see a little cloud. And it said the cloud the size of a man's hand, which I don't really know what that's about. Did it mean like that size or whatever? But there's a little cloud, and it rained. And all of that happened because Elijah prayed. And this is what James is saying. James is telling us, I want you to know prayer makes a difference. And when you pray for healing, this is important. Because God in his glory may choose to heal immediately right then, or may choose to use a doctor and heal in the next 2 weeks, or he might choose to take that person home and heal him with peace and joy through the journey of death. But either way, your prayer makes a difference. That's what James is saying. Get it? Pray, anoint with oil. Express your emotions to God. Look at verse 19 and 20. We're going to wrap this up. James reminds all of us, he says, my brothers, if any of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring him back, remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of his way will save him from death and cover over a multitude of sins. It's like almost shifting gears, right? Not really. Because remember, James's entire book is to help us understand that the Christian life is really not that complicated. All right? And I'll get back to that in a minute. But here in verse 19, he reminds all of us as believers. He says, listen, you guys, as believers in Jesus, you guys and ladies and everybody together, I want you to hook arms and I want you to help each other through the kingdom. I want you to help each other through life. And when someone fails, I want you to speak into his life. And I want you to challenge him and I want you to encourage him. And by the way, remember what we studied earlier. Don't bring condemnation, but get beside him and do life. So Reuben is going to be like, Steve, man, how can I walk through this with you? Or I'm going to be like, you know, Mark, like, I can tell, like, it doesn't feel like you're alive in Christ. Like, how can I walk through this with you? Like, how can I know what you're thinking? How can I see life from your perspective? That's what James is talking about. He says, let's come beside each other. Let's hook arms. Let's connect with each other's hearts. Let's bring people into that life of Christ. That's what James means. Let's rally each other on Sunday morning and worship. That's what I've been trying to do. Does this resonate? So James is saying this whole idea is, you know, life shouldn't be about me. As a church, as a body of believers. And again, as you know, I want you to study through the words of James on your own. I want you to dig through this because we missed a lot of points. But the message of James is, you know, the church, the family, this kingdom of God, it's not that complicated. I mean, it can be hard for sure. Remember the first book of James, he says, you know, if you have trials, you should be happy about that because it makes you a better person. Still remembering that. And you know it's going to bring results. But then he goes through all these points in James and he says, you know, I don't want you to know it all. I don't want you to have this kind of arrogance. I want you to show emotion together. I want you to be humble and confess your faults together. This is a family. This is a church. This is how we do church. So I think James's passion, and worship team, you guys can come on up. We're getting ready to wrap up. I think James's passion in this entire book is to help us to understand that the journey of being a Christian, right? Listen to me. The journey of being a Christian, the professing that we have of believing in Jesus is not that hard to figure out. But what it is humility. What it is crying out together. By all means, what it is expressing emotion to God and saying, God, we need you. We worship you, but we also desperately need you. And when we're sick, we're going to pray. We're going to anoint with oil. And we're going to rally together as a church. And when one fails, the other one's going to come beside him and say, dude, I'm here for you. Like, let's figure out how to get back into this life of Christ. Does that make sense? As followers of Jesus, as people that do church together, I believe James's words are so powerful for us. So my challenge, my desire, I hope this book stirred within you. It's not that complicated. This whole idea of walking with Jesus, being a church family. Let's do it. Would you stand with me? Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, this morning, I pray your power would just invade our minds, our spaces. And Jesus, you know, sometimes we just overcomplicate things or we get full of ourselves or we just stay arrogant or we think we have it figured out. And Jesus, I know that all of us in this room and online, we're walking through different parts of our journey. And some of us are in the fire. Some of us are in trials. Some of us are struggling with health issues. Some of us are desperately in need. And Jesus, some of us have failed and need to get back in tune with you. So God, I pray that you would use all of us. Every single one of us is part of this kingdom, this rally, this family, to walk beside each other, to cry out for healing, to express our emotions to you, and to be humble enough to express them to each other. And be a family, be your body. Lord Jesus, we love you. I pray that you'd lead us from this place in some kind of crazy special way that this week we could walk with you more than last week, with more passion, with more excitement, and by all means, with more confidence in you. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Beginning to the end, all my life is in your hand. This whole world may hold you down, but it can never drown you out. I'm not merely flesh and something more. You are God, you're the Christ who lives within me. From beginning to the end, you deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me. Christ who lives within me. From beginning to the end, you deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. You are God, you're the great I am. Breath of life I bring you in. Even in the fire, I'm alive in you. You are strong in my brokenness, sovereign over.
Let's give God a clap offering this morning. That was amazing. Great time together. Why don't we have a word of prayer yet? Dear God, thank you for the day that you've given us. Thank you for all of these like-minded people to come together and just praise and worship you and to help us to grow stronger in you and to have that prayer faith that we learned about today, God. Just thank you for everyone here. In your name we pray. Amen. I have a couple of announcements. Obviously, this afternoon is baptism. I think there's a pretty... quite a few people here, so come on out and support them. And also, you guys have probably seen the flyers for We Are Messengers. They are coming in, I think, they're coming very soon, okay? So if you scan the QR code on the flyers, you are able to get your, you scan the QR code, it'll take you right to the ticket app, and you can get your tickets right there. And if you want to put up flyers anywhere at your work or anything like that, Steve, I think, has quite a few of them sitting out in the center island there. And one other thing is Amy, our kids club is starting here in October 12th on a Wednesday night, and she is still looking for at least one teacher and three helpers. So if your kids are coming anyway, you might as well stay and help. So if you are interested in it, talk to Amy at the back, and she will get you squared away. So Lish has a couple of things that she wants to say yet, and then after that, I believe we're dismissed.
Yeah, so I know that there's some of you here in the congregation that have been looking for volunteer opportunities, but you're not sure kind of where you fit in maybe your skills or your talents or things that you're wanting to do, but you're wanting to find something to do here at church, well, I do want to let you know that there is an opening in the social media department of our church. So if you like taking pictures or would like to learn how to take better pictures and then posting that stuff onto social media, helping with getting some marketing out for events, kind of like that We Are Messengers event, if that interests you at all, please come speak to me after the service. I will just kind of be up along the stage here if you want to talk to me. If you don't have any background in that stuff, don't worry about it. We actually would like to take this time between now to the end of the year to train whoever would be interested in that sort of thing. And it would just be kind of something that you can do. It's a nice thing to do basically working from home. If that especially interests you, you don't have to be here to do all of that stuff. So if you have questions, you're interested, anything like that, come see me. Thank you.